In fact, Matthias, I see you're a white guy. Do you have a podcast?
Do I have a podcast? No, I listen quite a lot, but I don't have a podcast.
I'm a white passing guy. Also, I do have a podcast.
You have a podcast?
Yeah. And my podcast is about cinema, about film. I go to the Cannes Film Festival every year, and I saw one of the films you casted recently. Mm. It's one of the weirdest things I've ever done in my career, podcasting. And it took me a long, long time to figure out the tips and tricks, and I'm still halfway there, I think, into mastering that art form and mastering that medium. But we have two experts with us today.
Exactly. I think it's very interesting to have something that slows us down a little bit instead of consuming all the shit we want to see on Instagram. So yeah, invite them on stage, please.
Yeah, please. What? You need to?
They need to be mic'd.
Ooh.
Yeah.
Do we have a good...
We can make a podcast.
We can podcast together right now. Welcome to our podcast.
Okay.
Oh no, yeah. What is the podcasting market in Flanders today like? Because in the Netherlands it's been running crazy for the last year. We have podcasting awards here in Hilversum. We have found a lot of advertisers, which means that we have a lot of daily podcasts. These are really popular. Some of them reaching even 1 million, 2 million people.
From my experience, the market is growing quite a lot last year. There are still quite a lot of big ones, but there are also a lot of small ones popping up, like people trying stuff. But I think it's very interesting what they do. They take it to a next level, professional level. And it's the gap that's closing between the ideas of people doing it in their bedrooms or people doing it in a professional studio. And I think, yeah, the market is not as big as in Holland. For sure not. I think, but maybe they think differently, so they can.
Do they? Can we test the audio?
test.
Hello. Yeah. Yeah. Hi, a bit. No. Oh. Yes. There we go.
I don't hear myself.
Last audio check before we start. What did you guys have for breakfast this morning?
Nothing. A banana.
There's the banana.
I ate some yogurt.
No, nice. We're very healthy. Very healthy.
I hear
lifestyle.
That.
Yeah.
Okay. Ella, yeah. Sander, both working at as freelance podcast makers, VRT, Mediahuis. Please take the stage and teach us 10 things we need to know before making a podcast.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Hi, everyone. Maybe just a really easy question to start. Who has listened to a podcast at some time in their life? Show of hands. Okay. Who listens to podcasts like every week? Okay, every day maybe? Some people, almost? Okay, good to know. To know our audience before we give you some tips.
Yeah, so we're gonna talk about 10 things that we believe you should know before you dive into the market of podcasts and before you start creating, experimenting, making them.
Yeah, but maybe first, who are we? I'm Ella, I'm a freelance podcast maker. I do all sorts of stuff depending on what the client wants. Research, editing, scripting, producing, kind of whatever they want.
And a lot more, I think.
And a lot more. Yeah. And I've worked for VRT, which is our big national broadcaster in Flanders. I've worked for a big newspaper, all in podcasting, but it's actually all thanks to House of Media, where Sander works.
Yeah, so I work as a content creative at House of Media. And what we do is we co-create audiovisual projects. So we work together with brands and companies to create not only podcasts, but also videos, social content, photography, you name it. And we build an ecosystem of freelancers, including Ella. But we also have photographers, videographers, musicians, composers, copywriters, all the profiles that you need to create content nowadays. And the cool thing is, because we have this ecosystem, we can really work very modular towards what the client needs. For instance, some of our clients already have an audio cell and they just need somebody to do some post-production or some recordings. But we also have clients that don't have any knowledge of podcasting and they need everything from A to Z. So they really need a studio, they need an ID, they need a story, they need publishing, stuff like that. So we can help with the team and with the approach based on what they want. So that's really nice for us to, so that we can work where we are an added value and not just sell ourselves wherever we can. And if we're talking about podcasts, we make quite a lot of podcasts. I think we tried to count it. I don't know if the number will be super exact. It is about 25 hours of podcast per week. And it's really, it goes super broad. It's for the TV channels, it's for cultural institutions, broadcasters, FMCG brands, you name it. It goes from docus to spin-offs from television series, to some chatcasts about football, documentaries, more artistic projects, you name it. So it's really nice that, although it seems a pretty close or small medium, you can do a lot of things with it and really experiment with it.
But we do not only make podcasts, we are both fervent listeners as well, of course. So we thought maybe as an introduction, let's see what I listen to. This is very personal. I'm a bit self-aware now. You can see Sam Smith is over there. That's because I used to work at a radio station, which played only hits, and Spotify still knows that about me. It's still in the algorithm, so it's his latest single. But as you see, I have the Sunshine Place on the right side. It's the first steps of Robert Downey Jr. into podcasting. So you see, even the big guys are trying their best. But it's a good series. It's about this rehabilitation center in California, I think. But it's kind of becoming like a cult. And I'm really into true crime. And it's really good if you want to listen and be like, another cult, this is the one for you. And I'm also one of those people who falls asleep to podcasts, which is not very, it's like not really a compliment to tell someone, yeah, I listen to your podcast and then I fall asleep. So the trick is to find some a podcast that's really boring, actually, because if it's too interesting, I'll keep listening and I'll lie awake. So I'm listening to Sleep Cove, and it's just this man, and he's talking in his really low and slow voice, and he lulls me to sleep. And I brought an example. It should work, so you can listen to what I listen to every night. Oh, not working. I'll click it, maybe.
Wacht, I'm going to test it.
No. Ah, technology. I'll try.
Wacht, hè. Ja, op de laptop. Ik heb de laptop gehad, Luc.
Komt-ie.
Hello and welcome to Sleep Cove. The place to come for a great night's sleep.
Don't fall asleep
tonight,
now.
Tonight, I'll be reading some Greek mythology bedtime stories. I really hope you enjoy it. Hello and welcome.
I think you get the gist of it.
Kind of creepy.
Kind of creepy. I'm starting to listen to the Ziel van Parijs. It's a podcast that we made for Mediafin. It's based on the book of Dirk Sabbe. He tells a story about Paris, about the places that you need to visit, people you need to meet, and also about the history. And we turned it into an audio journey. So we followed him through the streets of Paris, meeting these people, meeting these places, visiting these places. And it's really cool because you really get a different perspective on Paris. So if you're planning a trip on Paris, really listen to this. It really helps. And the second one, Wind of Change, is like a CIA investigation podcast where there's a guy and there are some rumors about the song Wind of Change by the Scorpions that it wasn't written by the band, but it was written by the CIA, and it was part of a plan to stop the Cold War. So it's think Soviets, think spies, and tight leather pants. A really weird combination, but it seems really interesting. And for those of you who don't know Wind of Change, let's listen to a part of it. I'm blowing with the wind. Probably sounds familiar. Awesome song.
Yeah, but we're not here to listen to tight leather pants and Winds of Change. So yeah, 10 things you need to know before making a podcast.
Yeah, number one, what seems super straightforward, but it's really getting your story straight. And before you start making podcasts and diving into the rat race of making podcasts, because it seems that everyone's making them. This is an old one.
Oh.
I'm just going to jump a few slides.
Is
why do you want to make a podcast? Why do you want to tell it through a podcast? I think that's super crucial. It's a question that I think a lot of people don't ask themselves, because you really need to think about why is audio and why is podcast the way to tell my story. Why does it give an added value to what I want to say? I think that's really crucial because, for instance, sometimes an idea or a story can work better in print or in video or in a web series or whatever. But you really need to think about what's the objective that you want to reach while making the podcast. And one thing is that's super strong about podcasts is you can really get closer to your audience. You're literally inside somebody's ear. You join them while they go for a run, while they're in the kitchen, in the car, on holiday. So I think it's harder for a medium to get so close to people as podcasts.
Yeah, I think I once saw Tom Fordyce, who is the host of We Didn't Start a Fire. It's a history podcast. And he was telling about how someone came up to him and said, I felt asleep to your voice every night, which is kind of creepy to hear from someone. But it just goes to show how close you get to someone and how intimate, actually, a podcast can be. As I said, it's really, you get closer, you can really make people feel something. It's a whole different way of telling your story. For example, I made a podcast for the city of Antwerp, and it was part of a bigger campaign about racism and discrimination. So there were 5 people. These are the campaign images. They were all over the city. Those are the pictures. And they all have their story of how they were discriminated against. And it's one thing to see their pictures and they're all smiling and you're like, oh yeah, it's just a campaign. But to hear them tell you their story, like firsthand, it's really something else. And I think it adds a whole new layer. I brought a little fragment. Yeah, just you hear someone. It's a heavy story. And she's telling it and you can hear like the quiver in her voice. And it's just, I want to show you how
really it feels. Dat ik er beter mee zou kunnen omgaan als zoiets zou voordoen. En dan is hij echt gewoon op mij gevlogen. En dan werd het allemaal zwart. En dan zijn ze me heel veel erop moeten vliegen om die echt van mij af te sleuren. Maar dan hebben ze die direct buiten gezet. En dan de volgende dag direct naar het ziekenhuis en naar de politie om dat te gaan aangeven.
Yes, so she's talking about one time when she went out, she was attacked by someone. And it was a really difficult story for her to tell, of course, also in recording. And it was a really real moment while I did the recording. And I think you can hear it in the podcast as well. And that's something else than just reading someone's story. So just to show how close you can get to someone. You can also make people feel something in another way. By using technology, you can. It's really a playful medium. There's a lot of things possible. One example: one time I was listening to Gotrecht. It's a podcast by Fabrieo. It's crazy. It's fiction. It's a story about this woman, and she works at a company. And there's zombies, and there's magic copiers, and it's crazy. Just go listen to it. There's a lot of music. But they've completely recorded it with a 360 microphone. So it means you can record sound all around you. And I was listening to it while I was taking a walk. COVID, the only thing you could do was walk. And I was walking down the street and I'm listening to this podcast. And at one point they are yelling, "Grab that bitch." So it's this really crazy scene. And somebody yells, "Grab that bitch." But it really sounded like it came from right behind me, and I turned around because I thought someone was going to attack me because it sounded so real. And I think that's really cool, and it's full in development. There's new technology coming every day. So I'm really looking forward to what we can do with podcasting, but it makes you feel something. That's the point I want to make.
Yeah, and I think like the 3D in audio is a bit, it has a lower threshold than I think the 3D in video, because now with Dolby Atmos you can really have it in your ear pods or just your headphone. So it makes it very interesting to create very intense experiences only with audio, and that's really nice. It also allows you as a brand, as a TV channel, to extend your universe that you might already have, like a fan base, and also attract a new one at the same time. This is a TV show in Belgium or in Flanders, Over the Ocean, and it's actually they put 5 celebrities on a sailboat and they sailed across the Atlantic. So they're together in a small room for 5,000 kilometers. Good television. And we made a spin-off of this podcast about the show. So there was a reporter on board, and she talked with the candidates, with the celebrities. And it was a bit behind the scenes listen of what was going on the boat. It was really interesting because the fans got more content. They didn't only have the show on TV, they could also listen to the podcast. But also we attracted a new audience that didn't know the show, but were frequent podcast listeners. So that was really interesting to see how you can both attract new audience and give your current audience a bit more content to feed on.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, another reason to want to make a podcast is because you can build a community if you do it right. This is the Instagram feed of Keihard, a podcast by Dalila Hermans and Josephine Daalmans. Two amazing women from Flanders, and they just, it's their show, they talk about it, choose a topic every week and they talk about it. But they have this feed, and it's, as you can see, it's clearly built to a format, and you get this, these listeners who are really, you can feel that they are listening every week and they give input, they send messages, and they are really engaged. So you can see a podcast, is, it feels really personal, as I said, and that's why people are so connected. If you get them, they are really engaged, and you have to build that community, and then you can keep it. But it's a really, it feels like a warm hug sometimes. These people, it's just, it feels like they are really your friends, and I think that's a difference with a movie or just advertising or anything. It feels like it's really personal. It's also... like Matthias said, it's slow, actually, podcasts. We're really used to getting fast news, but we also saw during the lockdowns that people, there was this distrust to the traditional media. We didn't believe everything. There's a lot of fake news going around, and we're not sure what to believe. And I think podcasts is a really good way to kind of fill in that gap, because it's way more trustworthy. It shows integrity. It's authentic. So it's a really good idea for just newspapers and media companies to invest in podcasting and to just dig deeper, because you have more time and you can go deeper, for example. And also, yeah, sometimes podcasts can become the news, because this one is from The Australian, a big Australian newspaper, and they made The Teacher's Pet. It's about this case that was never really solved. And this journalist just goes into... it goes into an investigation, and he finds new clues, new suspects and everything. And now, actually, there's been a breakthrough. Someone has been convicted. There's this new, well, they just really found the true dader. I lost the word. Anyway, the murderer. So it really made a difference. It really made a change. And I think that's only possible because you can take your time making a podcast and just dig deeper.
And it's also, I think the speakers before us were talking about niche. In podcasts, you can never be too niche because there are fandoms everywhere. I think we have the feeling that the more niche you go, the more chances you have on building a big fan base. For instance, you could listen to wrestling, to shoujo manga, which is a type of manga for young women, but you can even listen to a podcast to know all about Dolly Parton. And that's just the tip of the iceberg. There are a lot of very niche topics out there, and so if you, as a maker, or you work at a brand, or at an ad agency, or a media company, you have an idea, you say, or you think it might be too niche, too narrow for a newspaper or on television, podcast might be an interesting way or an interesting angle to look at. We always say niche is the new mainstream in podcasts, because it's our experience that we see, because it also helps to start a story very close to a personal story, very, very small, very simple, and from that story start talking about bigger topics, giving more context, more bigger themes to it. Mm-hmm. And a cool thing is also you can experiment and create new listening opportunities. Gimlet, which is the production agency of Spotify, they make a lot of podcasts for Spotify, they made... podcast for kids to listen to while they're brushing their teeth. So every episode is about 2 minutes, so the time you need to brush your teeth. And they sing songs, they tell you how to brush your teeth, their riddles, short investigation stories. And it's really nice because before that there wasn't any any listening opportunity there, but they created something which is also has a really added value, we believe, and it also shows that you can be really creative with just audio. And I think we brought a small piece with us.
Good morning. It's time for Chompers, your morning and night toothbrushing show. It's Stories Week, and today our story is about Dev the detective and the case of the missing flashlight. But first, pick a side on the top of your mouth and start brushing in small circles all the way around each tooth.
Three, two, one,
brush. Dev the detective has just gotten a call from little old lady.
Yeah, and then the story begins about a detective that's missing his flashlight. I think now we need to go back.
Yeah, or I'll just tell them.
I'll help you with some visuals.
Yeah, so if you figured out you really want to make a podcast, because think about it, why you want to make a podcast, make sure that you know what you want to tell, to who you want to tell it, and how you want to tell it. It's important because there are a lot of podcasts out there. Certainly, during the pandemic, everybody bought a microphone and just started talking. You have to, on Apple Podcasts alone, there are 2 million podcasts, 48 million episodes. So you have to make sure that you stand out, that your podcast is something new, is something people want to listen to. And there's just a lot of ways. I'm not going to go very deep into that, just to show you. There are a lot of genres and a lot of ways to tell the story, a lot of forms. You can make a documentary, which is mostly, most of the time, it's a series of different episodes. You can make a studio podcast, but that's just the way you record it. You can think, I want to make a series, but bring people in every time. Do you bring different people in? Do you have a panel, and it's always the same people in your studio? Do you have the microphone in your hand? Will you go put it under someone's nose somewhere? Do you want a personality in your podcast? It's just, or do you want to write fiction, which is also possible, but it's just, it's a whole world of genres and forms, and you just need to think about which one you want to choose, not just, I'm going to make a podcast, think it through, because that's important. When you get your story straight, that's what will make sure you have a good podcast, and that will make you stand out among.
Yeah, and also I think also very important for planning and budget. If you just make a podcast only in a studio, it's a completely different budget than if you're doing it on location, or you also want to record some sounds there, like a river or some air or whatever. So if you think about in the beginning how you want it to sound, what your different blocks are that you want to make or record. It's good to know in advance to start making planning, but also start making your budget.
I think we brought some numbers just to give you an idea of the fastest growing podcast genres of last year. True crime is the absolute winner. I'm also a big fan, so I'm not surprised. But maybe kind of surprising, I don't know, history is also really famous or really popular. A lot of history nerds out there, so you can hop on that train if you want to. Fiction also really popular, and it's not the easiest for genre to make because it's writing, and it's the same as for television. You're writing a story and you're thinking about characters and everything, but it's
I think it's
popular.
Even more intense than
non-fiction.
Than video, because you don't, you only have audio.
Yeah.
You don't have I think you don't have the visual cues to play with. But then you see like streaming services like Apple, they have a show called Calls. I don't know if anybody heard it, because it's on their platform. There are just some visuals, but it's actually a show, very short, about, it's always about people calling each other, but it's always like these weird science fiction kind of stories, but it's really cool, and they only have audio and some visuals of like, I don't know how you say it.
The audio waves?
The audio waves, yeah. But it's super, super well made. So even streaming, visual video streaming platforms are also experimenting with audio. Mm-hmm. Netflix was experimenting with audio only, so that you can, while you're on the go, on the bike, and you want to check out your favorite series, you can listen to it. So they're also experimenting with that. So that's really interesting to see how video is doing, or experimenting with less video and more audio. Mm-hmm. Yeah. Okay, I'm gonna skip all those. We had those.
Yeah. So first thing is just get your story straight to make sure you stand out. Second thing sounds maybe a bit odd, but start on paper. I know you think I just want to grab a microphone, put it under someone's nose, start recording. But believe me, start on paper. Why? Because actually your most expensive time is the time editing and I'm forgetting. Editing is what I'm, no studio time. That's what I was going to say. Studio time and editing are your most expensive parts of your production process. So the more you do on paper beforehand, the more efficient you will be in that last step of editing. So first thing you want to do is just your format. Think it all the way through. If you think I have an idea, okay, write it down. I have an example actually. Club Net is a podcast I'm helping make. For VRT, the broadcaster, and this is just really a short version of the exercise we did. Mostly it's a few pages long. So what is it, your weekly dose of internet? Why? It's to be a guide in the abundance of the internet and to build the brand. The audience is people on the internet, but mostly millennials and Gen Z. Style is conversational, nothing too serious and full of amazement, and length is about 20 minutes. Why do you need this? This is just your backbone. Once you start making it, a lot of things change, and if you're feeling like, I'm not really sure about the product that I'm making, you can always go back to that backbone and check, oh yeah, this is what I wanted to make, and this is what I have. Where is it going wrong, or where is it going right? Do I need to change some things?
Yeah, and also if you want to pitch it.
Yeah.
Eventually, you'll have to probably pitch it, whether it's internally, externally, or if you want some fundings, you need it in writing somewhere. And sometimes you don't have the time or the budget to make a teaser, like a short clip of how it would sound. So then this comes really in handy.
Yeah, it does. Second thing is your recording script. Also, this sounds like extra work because you can grab the microphone, start asking questions. But it's just, I do it every time. Before I go somewhere, I think about to an interview. I think, what do I want to get out of this interview? What is the information? What is the story I want to get out of this? Because it helps in editing later on. I brought an example. I had a podcast I made for the city of Antwerp I was talking about previously. I knew their story already because I talked to them beforehand. We called, they told me their story already. I was like, okay, these phone calls were more than an hour and the podcast was only 15 minutes. So I had to think, okay, which elements am I going to take? So I did that one. Then I thought about the kind of structure I wanted them to tell their story into. And also my voice would be cut out in the end, so you wouldn't be hearing me. So I had to make sure I asked questions they could answer without my help. So I could just tell me your story, but I had to make sure they could answer them as easily as possible without me intervening, because my voice could not be in the end. So that's why it's important to make a recording script. It goes for every kind of podcast. Even studio podcasts I made, we have a script always. It's just a backbone and it makes it easier in the rest of your process. Transcription, really boring, really necessary. You have to transcribe, so put all your audio into writing. Takes a lot of time, but it helps you a lot in the process, especially if you're working together with a whole team and other people. Why? Because you cannot search your audio. If you're like, oh yeah, I remember I had this one piece where they were telling about this little part, yeah, you cannot. If you have to listen to your whole tape every time again to find it, it's really time consuming. So better to consume your time one time here and then just control F to your the part of the story that you want.
And because the first edit is always made on paper.
On paper, yeah.
Which sounds a bit weird, but you always make it on paper first. And I think, Ella, you're the expert there. because it saves you precious time and money. Because if you would dive into the program already starting with, here I want to put music and VO, then it becomes really, really time consuming and expensive. So we make it on paper, see where we want to add music, where we want to add a voiceover, like a voice that helps with the story, that helps to create the red thread.
You can take it literally. I print out all of my transcription, I cut out the pieces I want, and I put them in well, my wall becomes a podcast before I actually make the podcast.
So your house is filled with papers?
My house is it's just, that's my interior design. It's just scripts. But how do you get the most out of your interview? Because that's also really important. Post-production can fix a lot of stuff, but it cannot fix everything. If you don't have the right material, you can't recover it or you can't fake it. So just some quick tips on how to get the most out of your interview is, I always ask them, take me to the moment. So you want their story, I ask them, take me to the moment. I was never there, so describe everything to me. Pretend like it's a movie, your life is a movie. Describe what you see, what you feel, what you hear, because you have to keep in mind your listener doesn't have an image. So if somebody just starts talking, it can be interesting. But if they paint this picture and you can start imagining what it's like and where they are, it's just way more interesting. So that's my first go-to question. Second one is really easy. I just ask them 1,000 times, what do you mean? Because I'm a big Justin Bieber fan as well, but also because it's a really useful question. It allows them to dig deeper into their own story. Don't be shy, don't be scared that it's kind of awkward that you're there sitting like, what do you mean? Like you're stupid. Don't worry, it's our nature as human beings to be flattered if somebody asks a lot of questions. So don't worry about that and just ask them again and again and again, what do you mean? Because in my experience, the second time they tell their story is most of the time the one I use in the final product, because they tell it just a lot better than the first one. And third tip is just repeat. Yeah, maybe Sander, mm-hmm. I'll try it on you. Yeah. How was your morning?
My morning was really good. We didn't have any traffic jam driving here, so that was nice.
No traffic jam?
It only took us 2 hours and a half.
2 hours and a half?
Yeah, that was okay. I had very good company.
Oh, good company.
I don't know if you know her, Ella.
Oh, yes. Yeah. Ella. You see, it was a really short example, but what I do a lot of time is just repeat one word out of their last sentence or what they said, because it shows interest and it's not really a question. So they're like, you want to know more about what I'm telling you, and they just once again dig deeper and deeper without you having to ask what do you mean all the time. So you just pick out the right words and they just keep on talking. So these are just some quick tips on how to make the most out of your interview.
Yeah, when you have your ID, you want to know what you want to make, how it's really, and you start making it, it's really important to like they do on TV shows, make a pilot. So not spend all your budget in making all of the episodes and then finding out some things might not work as we planned out. So make a pilot, take your ID, take your workflow, the style you have in your mind, take them for a test drive. See if it works, because until now it's just stuck in your head. You talked about it with people, with your team, you've written it down, but now everything comes together. All the pieces of the puzzle come together and you really hear it. So some things might not work. Some ways of working might not work. The style you had in mind might not be the right one. The music, the people you spoke to. So making a pilot is really crucial. And in budgeting, we split it up. We have a budget for the pilot and then for the other episodes, because the pilot normally costs a bit more because you are experimenting. So it's really, really important to take also time for feedback in your planning. Take time to digest the pilot, what happened, what was good, what was bad, what things that you need to change. That's something that in the beginning we sometimes forgot, but yeah, practice taught us that we really need to consider that time. It's really valuable, because all the decisions you make in the pilot will have an impact on all the other episodes that are to come. And also, you may or may not notice, but making a podcast is one hell of a job, and it takes two to tango, and it takes a team to make a podcast. This is one we made for Go Play. It's a spin-off from Top Doctors, a TV show about the best doctors in Flanders. And for this podcast, TV face Pedro Elias, who is also, he suffers from hypochondria, so he always thinks that he's ill, or he's going to die, or has an illness. And he visits the doctors from the TV show, and they scan them completely from his toe to his liver to his eyes to see if he doesn't have anything wrong with him. And there we had we had editors for a story, we had a designer for, of course, the visual. We had a producer to make sure we got our deadlines. Engineers for the technical part, for the recordings, also on location. We had an editor-in-chief that kept the overview and quality check of everything. And then the sound designers who made the music, did the editing, the mixing, the mastering, all those. So a lot of people. Now, you don't need to have all those people. You can do some things yourself, but for us, practice taught us that if we have the budget and the time to select a team, we will, because the more things that one person does, often the quality diminishes. So if somebody is an editing, but also an editor in chief, you feel it, and it's also very hard for one person to carry, because a podcast takes some time to make, and it has to be fun for everyone. So, and also start using tools for collaboration. So don't use Pages or Word locally with a final V1, final V2. That's not from these days anymore. There are a lot of cloud-based tools you can work together remotely, but it's super important that, because you're working with a team, that everybody can access documents, can work on it. For instance, we use Notion for planning and for our scripting, and we use Dropbox for sharing audio mixes, videos, and giving feedback. But there are others out there, I think even better ones than the ones we use. But our workflow is now based on these.
Yep.
And you also need an ally in your team.
get yourself a good producer. I know you think, I can do this myself, I can make my own planning, meet my own deadlines. It's true, but experience has taught me it's just really awesome to be a tandem. That if you're focusing on the content, if it's your story you're telling, you really want to focus on that. You want to focus on the storytelling. You don't want to get the client and they're I don't know, if they're not happy with something and they come directly to you. It's really just, it's very hard to do. And if you have a producer, there's just someone who always has your back, who will defend you towards the client. It's just someone to be a team with and to work close together. It's also someone who will worry about all the budgeting, all the planning, all the deadlines. If you're like, I'm not meeting my deadline, it's no longer your problem. You're just telling your producer, and then it becomes my problem, and I can have all the stress, but I'll fix it. So that's why it's really nice to have a good producer, and it really helps in your process. Just to give an idea, these are all the steps you need to take into account in your planning. I've made some monstrous plannings, and I think it's just a good idea to give that responsibility to someone else so you can focus on what you're making and the story you want to tell. So that's just a tip from my experience, but by all means, do what you, if you're like a really good planner, go ahead. You can really do it yourself, but it's just really nice to have a producer.
And we also found out that a podcast nowadays is more than just audio. A good podcast can be more than a host, some voices, and some music. You can really go further, go deeper into exploring that. On the one hand, it is also visual, and I'm not just referring to the tiles you find in the libraries. There's a Flemish podcast, Computer Club. And they talk about two friends, and they talk about everything technology, innovation related. And their style, like on their Instagram, on their website, is like these 90s internet era messenger and those bit style visuals. But they also have merch that is almost already sold out. I never got the chance to buy one. They got caps, they got hoodies. So they really bring their podcast, their community alive. You can listen to it, you can wear it, you can look at it on your phone through Instagram, and that's really, really cool. And you also see a lot of podcasts making videos. We call it vodcast. For the Stem of Anassis, which is a podcast that we make for the newspaper in Flanders, it's kind of like a true crime podcast where journalists talk about cases. And we also made a video. It's a really, really easy, low production video. It's just a one shot of them sitting like in an interrogation room. And talking about these cases. So people can listen to it or they can watch. They have the choice. Some guys go even further. This is something that was some friends started in Australia. We got the chocolate. I don't really like it, but I found the podcast through TikTok because they use these super funny bits of their podcast, telling dad jokes or one-liners, those bad jokes. It's really, really funny. And they use it on TikTok to get people into their podcast or their vodcast. So they really use other platforms, cut up their end product, cut up their video, their vodcast, in order to attract new people, new audiences. But it can also be content. You can use it on different platforms you already have, for instance, or the brand that you're working for. You can add it in your content strategy. This was one we made for another newspaper. It's about two young investors. We each gave them 10,000 euros, and they could invest according to their strategy. And we followed them to see which made the smartest decisions. And we turned it into different articles and blog posts, again, attracting an audience to come and listen to the podcast. But it can also be part or a spearhead of a campaign. For instance, the podcast Ella made, Allemaal Antwerpenaar, it was part of a bigger campaign for the city of Antwerp against racism and discrimination. And one of the biggest elements from that campaign, besides postering and online content, was the podcast, because that was the only moment you could really hear personal stories of people that were victim of discrimination and of racism. And they linked it to other touch points. You had billboards with QR codes that you could scan to listen to the podcast. They did an activation in the station of Antwerp with, you can see it, with like these quotes of people. If you scan the QR code, you could listen to the voice of those people. So it's really interesting. But you can even go further. This is an app called Zombies Run. It's actually an app that helps you to run, helps you to train, and you listen to the story of a zombie apocalypse. But every once in a while, or if you do a certain training, you can hear zombies creeping up on you really fast from behind, and you need to start running faster. So it's a mixture of a game, running app meets podcast. It's something in between, but it's really interesting to see how you can experiment with that, to really try it out.
If you dare.
If you dare.
Another one is, good podcasts don't have listeners, they have fans. If you think groupies and fans are something for rock stars only, think again, because this is one of my favorite podcasts of all time. It's called My Dad Wrote a Porno. And it's exactly that. It's this guy in the middle, and his dad wrote this really bad, really horrible, and hilarious erotic novel. Just to give you an idea how bad it is, the title is Belinda Blinked. Yes, what exactly? It doesn't get better. That's just. But it's just them. It's him, and those are two friends of his. They each have a microphone, they sit down in his kitchen, and they just start reading. And it's one chapter per episode, and it's just hilarious. They laugh a lot, they make jokes. And I've multiple times I was laughing out loud and even crying in public spaces or on the train, and people were really looking really weird at me. But it's hilarious. If you need a good laugh, do try it. But it's a bit dark, but you can see them. They are standing in the Sydney Opera House. And behind them, like, the whole room is filled with people. It's a lot of people, and they
special
are
special guest. There's somebody entering.
Yeah. No, but they're on a world tour with their podcast. World tour. They have an HBO comedy special. They are going places, and it's just because the three of them were sitting in his kitchen.
Very niche.
Very
something
niche.
Super
very
niche.
Yeah. Well, it's actually because his dad wrote a porno, but
which is also niche.
Also niche. So yeah, it's really, you can become a rock star by making podcasts. You can dream big, you can get there. If you think it's only for UK or America, once again, think again. This is a picture from this year's first podcast festival in Flanders. And all these people are waiting to get inside for this live recording of the Volksjury, which is a true crime. Well, not really a true crime. It's like two friends, two women and they really love unsolved murder cases, so they pick one every episode and they just start speculating about what happened. That's nothing scientific. They're doing research, but they are not doing any investigation or anything. They're just like, I think this happened. No, I think this happened. And it's funny. And it's really popular because all these people just showed up, all wearing their merch. And it shows how strong the community can be if you do it right, your podcast.
Yeah, and I think that's also something that, if you make podcasts professionally or for bigger companies, to still keep that personal human element intact, not to be too perfect, too over mixed, too over produced. And I think that's something that, yeah, we're still growing and learning, because sometimes you want that really high quality level of execution, and sometimes you don't. Because it's super easy to set up. Eh? It's just two mics and they're talking, but people like it and they come out in numerous numbers. So that's really, really cool to see that it still is it's like a grassroots movement, mm-hmm. and a lot of popular podcasts are.
Yeah.
To still harness that as well. Even though we're making them professionally, still that's super important to keep in mind.
Yeah.
And I think, yeah, for brands, I think it's interesting to see these fans, and I think it's not the time to be on mute also for brands or for companies to start, yeah, looking into it, learning about it, experimenting with it, but also try looking to see if buying ad space for your product or brand is as interesting as creating high quality content for your target audience, so to say, to create fans about your product. I think it's a very interesting way of thinking or looking towards podcasts, but also towards content, and then even bigger towards advertising and communication.
And then also a really obvious one, but you'd be surprised about how much work there is once you finish a podcast. So you're making it, it's done, you've done all the editing, you're happy, but then you need people to listen to it. So you need to publish your podcast and you want people to listen to it. So I'll just give you some steps to go through. You need a trailer, first of all. A good one. You want people to be excited for your podcast, to listen to it, and to lure them in for the rest of your episodes and your series. So you need that, but it has a practical side to it, because you don't upload your podcast directly onto Spotify or Apple Podcasts. You upload it on a hosting platform and they upload it for you. But the big ones, like Spotify and all, are really critical. They need to check your content before they upload it. So you upload your trailer and then you just wait. There's like not really, you don't know how long it will take. It can be 2 weeks, it can be a day, but you're not sure. So that's why we always make a trailer first, put it on the platform, and then we wait until it comes online. And once that one is online, it means that your content is, it was all right and you can go. So then it becomes more trustworthy and your episodes will appear at a normal time frame. So a trailer has like two purposes, but it's important to have one. Oh yeah, we brought an example.
Ik ben Ella Leijers. Toen ik naar Over de Oceaan zat te kijken, vroeg ik me heel de tijd af, zou dat iets voor mij zijn? Met 5 onbekende bekenden en een televisieploeg 3 weken lang doorheen geschud worden op een oceaan. Weg van alles en iedereen, zou ik dat kunnen? En vooral, hebben ze alles er niet een beetje beter laten uitzien dan het echt was? In deze podcast ga ik dat onderzoeken. Hoe gevaarlijk dat eigenlijk is, zo'n overtocht. En hoe groot de kans is dat ik zee- of geestesziek word. Luister vanaf 11 januari naar Over de Oceaan op je favoriete podcast-app.
So it was fun. I think for the first series, she wasn't on board. It was after.
Yeah.
It was recorded after, and then for the second series, she was on board with the 5, so with the mic and the audio gear. So that was quite fun.
I brought some examples of those hosting platforms, but just to give you an idea, there's a lot of them out there. They all have the same purpose, but it's some are free. I think the three on top are free, and then other ones are paying, but they all have different features. It's just do your research, take your pick, and they all do the same, just to give you an idea. And then also don't forget your title and show notes. It feels like this last step, and by then you're maybe sick of your own podcast and you just want it out there. But do pay some attention to these two, because it's the only thing you have in writing for your podcast. If people search for your podcast, they're going to search for your title. So you want to make it clear, as clear as it can be. If it's about the topic, make sure that the topic is in the text, because then if they Google it, it will come up. Also, your show notes are like kind of your way of talking to your audience. You can put some extra stuff in there. For Keihard, for example, we always put a lot of articles, research papers and stuff in there, so listeners can read more on the topic of that episode if they want to. Just don't forget them. They are a big help for people to find your podcast and to listen to it.
Yeah, and find if you're launching or you want to extend your audience or your podcast, find podcast friends, find people that have a link with your podcast. It can be story-wise, concept-wise, same philosophy behind it, or you just like them, or audience-wise. Find friends and find ways you can or should collaborate, sharing fans, sharing success. This might seem a bit hippie and utopian, but it happens, and I'm really glad that it happens. For instance, this is a podcast, Damn Honey, that did a promo about vrouwentoilet and vice versa on their Instagram feed. So just helping each other out because they believe in each other and they support each other's cause. This is a podcast for a newspaper, Sex Verandert Alles, Sex Changes Everything. And in their episode list, they put the first episode of another podcast series, Tot Onze Grote Spijt. And then you can also guest if you make a podcast as a host. You can also visit other podcasts and have a chat there to talk about what you're doing, to talk about your podcast. This is Dalila Herman from the podcast Keihard that Ella made, and she was guesting on another podcast called 50 Coffees.
And then the last one, the last thing you need to know before making a podcast is that your first and last seconds are crucial. It's the first thing people hear, and if those are right, you will bind those listeners to you forever, for eternity. You have about 60 seconds to grab people, or they'll go elsewhere. It sounds dramatic, but it's in essence, it's really true. If you get them hooked, they will stay. So I brought an example. Yeah. Is it playing already? No. So this is Not Past It from Gimlet, once again, the production company bought by Spotify, and now their production company. And they are just, I think it's a creative way of using that information of those first 60 seconds. And you can feel that they know this is the most important.
Yeah, and you have they play with it literally. We'll play it in a second. But you have different ways of different techniques of doing it. What we often do, if it's about more a doku or a personal story we're telling, is not just start with this is the podcast about blah, 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 but start with a situation. Start with that you just enter a situation, you hear somebody talking, you hear something's falling or whatever, and you're inside of a story, and then you give the explanation. So people are hooked and are wondering like what's happening here.
Yeah, put but them into a scene.
Yeah, you have different ways. Mm-hmm. Hit it.
I hit it.
I can't. I think.
Very profesh.
Hi, I'm Simone Polanin, and I'm the host of a new weekly show from Gimlet about history. And wait, before you skip this, yes, it's a history show, okay, but it's not like a boring history show. It's called Not Past It, and it's all about the weird and interesting and crazy things that have happened in the past. I'm not a historian or a scholar, but I am a writer, a filmmaker, and a, you know, all-American, girl-next-door, Maxim hometown hottie type. I've got a microphone, a decent internet connection, and frankly, a lot of questions. Like, what's the deal with the alternative uses of cornflakes?
The rumor on the internet was that it was created to prevent masturbation in young men.
And why don't we have an AIDS vaccine yet?
Oh, we think we have the vaccine. This went on every single year. 85, 86, 87, 89, 90, 91. And none of it went anywhere.
And how does a baseball pitcher play the game of his career?
Yeah.
But who would listen to it? Good test? No, you don't have to. Nobody.
What? Two, three, four, five.
Okay. I thought I'm not a history fan. Well, we should be. It's important. But I'm not really. My attention span can't handle long historical stuff. But this one is really good. And I think it's a good example because you can hear them. They are playing with the idea, I only have 60 seconds and I already know history sounds boring, so I'm gonna, it's really meta and I like it. And then this, goes without saying, use cliffhangers or teasers. It's the same with movies and television or video. It keeps it interesting and it makes your listener want to listen to the next episode. So that's the same technique.
Yeah, but also there you have different strategies and I think even the video streaming services are experimenting with that. It's sometimes we launch in bulk, we say, so all the episodes at once, mm-hmm. So people can binge. Or sometimes we have a weekly podcast that we do once a week. Sometimes it's linked with the news and actualiteit, so we literally make it live, so to say. But sometimes you already make it in advance, but we just drop it once every week. It depends on what your objective is, what your goal is. So also there are different ways, but teasers, even if you launch them, or cliffhangers, if you launch them in bulk or separate, it really helps to build suspense.
I brought a teaser. We listened to. Do we have time? Just an example of how teasers work in podcasting. If it's a series, so I brought The Sunshine Place, and it just really. You just say, this is what's going to happen on the next episode. And you provide interesting quotes from your next episode. So I just brought an example to give you an idea.
Next time on The Sunshine Place.
I never met anybody like Chuck. His personality was overwhelming.
We go all the way back to the beginning. Chuck brings Sinanon to life, and his followers line up behind him.
I never met a person who had the charisma, the ability just to fold in people into his orbit.
Not everyone embraces Sinanon.
Everybody had washed their hands of addicts. Once an addict, always an addict.
But Chuck has a vision, and he knows how to sell it.
You wait and see. Those three syllables, Sinanon. They're going to be a household word, as familiar to the world as Coca-Cola.
So, as you can hear, it's just, this is going to happen, and then you hear some interesting quotes, and it makes me want to listen to the next episode, so it really works. It's classic, but it does the job.
I think that about wraps it up. Here are the 10 things we wanted to share with you from our experience. Hope you learned a thing or two that you can take home with you. And if there are any questions, shoot. Thanks a lot.
Thank you, guys. We're also running a bit behind on schedule,
yeah,
so I can give you one question, and afterwards you're still here, right?
Probably
depends on
depending
the hour
on the traffic. Traffic, yeah.
We want to leave before traffic. I don't know if we're gonna make that.
I think
let's see.
We'll find you on Instagram.
Quite
either way.
A lot of questions, I guess.
Yeah.
But we also
a lot of information, luckily.
Yeah.
Our email was on the slide, so people can always email us or Instagram.
Where is it again?
It was on the slide, but
can you take us back just so we can like photograph it or?
Does someone has a question in the room?
Yeah, we have it, but I think that the tech setup needs to.
Oh yeah.
And guys, 3, 2, 1. Screen is working. Usually, when I do this, it works.
Magic.
Magic.
No, I had a question.
Yeah.
How do you get a look on all the data, because you make it, you put all the creative energy in it, you produce everything, and at the end you have, of course, the listeners. Mm-hmm. Is there a way to analyze the data? Is there a way to look at your audience? Just because you know your fans probably, because you're in right direct contact with them, but is there a...
Well, that's actually, it's a good question, because a lot of time when we work with clients and they're like, okay, how many listeners do we have? But it's a really difficult question, because it's not that much in the beginning, mostly, because what we see with podcasting is that the numbers of listeners, it grows organically. So you can publish an episode and it is not really popular, and then like a year later you have it has multiplied by 10 times or something. Or imagine you made a podcast about the queen and then she dies. Yeah, of course your podcast is going to boom. So and I don't think there's not like a universal way of analyzing the data.
I think not yet.
We're getting there, but it's part of how we are still developing as a sector.
Yeah, and I think in Flanders we're in terms of making podcasts, we're a bit behind of Netherlands, I think. Yeah. They're a bit further in the quality and in how they also how they analyze their data.
Mm-hmm.
But it's still a tough nut to crack, and we also don't have always the access to the numbers, because we make them for those media companies, so it's always it's always an in between of getting the numbers or talking about it. Sometimes they don't want to share it, sometimes they do. Mm-hmm. It's
not
tricky.
It's not that you analyze it, but this was a good story. We have such a number of listeners.
Well,
we do,
but not all the time.
Okay.
I think for the newspapers, for DPG, because they're really number focused also, we do it.
Mm-hmm.
But we saw, okay, the Beurs van Charlotte and Cedric had, I don't know by heart how many listeners it was, but that was growing slowly but steady.
Yeah.
Okay, number nerds, I'm gonna cut you short.
Yeah, sorry.
Gonna you can talk numbers all you want after this. Round of applause again, Ella.
Thank you.
Thank you.
And Sander.